Good morning and welcome. I would like to read our welcoming statement. Please feel free to join wherever you find yourself. Believing that God's unbounded love and grace as taught by Jesus are offered to all and meant to be shared and celebrated by all, we embrace persons of every race, age, sexual orientation, ethnic and religious background, physical and mental ability, and economic means as vital and integral members of God's family. As an open and affirming congregation, we welcome everyone to participate in the life and worship of our church. Amen and amen.
We're going to start this morning with a unison prayer, and it's based off of the prayer, the O Father, Thou art in heaven, but it has been rewritten in the perspective of it being our mother. So you can read along if you would like to. Our mother, which art thy earth, nurturing are thy ways. Thy web of life be woven, thy way be found within, as it is all around. Thank you this day for our daily bread and sweat, and forgive us our misuse of you, as we forgive others their misuse of us. And lead us not into exploitation, but deliver us from lording it over you and over each other and over all our other fellow creatures. For thine are the waters of life, the hills, the valleys, and plains of home, the breeding, seeding, feeding ground, for now and for as close to forever as we will ever come. Ah, woman, our father, mother, who are in the world and surpass the world, blessed be your presence in us, in animals and flowers, in still air and wind. May justice and peace dwell among us as you come to us. Your will be our will. You will that we will be sisters and brothers, as bread is bread, water is itself, for our hunger, our quenching of thirst. Forgive us. We walk crookedly in the world, are perverse and fail of our promise. But we would be human if only you consent to stir up our hearts. Amen. We're now going to have time with the children. It's going to be with me, Kelly. So if your kids are around, go ahead and grab them. I have a really great book that we're going to be reading today. It's called Interstellar Cinderella. And I bought this book a couple of years ago because when I saw it, I really liked the message that it was showing. And I think that you'll like it too. You might be familiar with this story, but it kind of has a little bit of a twist to it. I'm gonna give you a hint just based off the title and tell that it's probably gonna have something to do with Cinderella, but she's wearing something a little different. So let's find out how she's different than the regular Cinderella. So it says, once upon a planetoid, amid her tools and sprockets, a girl named Cinderella dreamed of fixing fancy rockets. She fixed the robot dishwashers and Zoom brooms in her care. But late each night, she snuck away to study ship repair. One day, her wicked stepsisters came dashing in, excited. The Prince's Royal Space Parade, our family's invited. I wish that you could come, my dear. Alas, no room, although, why don't you fix that broken ship and fly it to the show? That's not very nice. My toolbox, Cinderella cried. We're stranded here, I guess. But Murgatroyd the mouse sent out a cosmic SOS. And in case you don't know what SOS means, SOS means save our ship, which basically means, we're in an emergency. Help us. I'm here, your fairy god robot. I'll make you brand new tools. You'll need a spacesuit too, of course, atomic blue with jewels. This power gem will speed your ship across the starry sky. It only lasts till midnight. After that, your ship won't fly. Oh, thank you, Cinderella said. She quickly fixed the rocket, then tucked the sonic socket wrench inside her spacesuit pocket. She zoomed past stars and nebula and parked beside a moon. The space parade was glorious. Each starship made her swoon. At last, the royal ship approached with her heart was filled with burning. The ship of Cinderella's dreams, but heavens, what was burning? My goodness, that's not good. The prince's spaceship jerked and hissed and spewed a cloud of grit. The prince hopped out. Oh, blast, what now? My chief mechanic quit. But interstellar Cinderella knew just what to do. She zip-zapped with her socket wrench. The ship was as good as new. The prince invited her abroad. Last stop, Galactic Hall. He said, I hope you'll join me for the gravity-free ball. They talked for hours of rocket ships. That time went whizzing by. Then Cinderella saw the clock and said, I have to fly. But wait, the prince called out after her. Please tell me how to find. The girl was gone, but she had left her socket wrench behind. What's she gonna do? What's he gonna do? The prince sent a transmission to the farthest edge of space. I'll search the cosmos for her. How I wish I'd seen her face. The prince's ship, Griselda screeched. Her sister squealed in fear. The prince won't marry one of us if Cinderella's here. Their mother said, don't worry, he won't find her in this house. I've trapped her in the attic with that useless robot mouse. It's a very sad, like, that's very unfortunate right now. It's a little silly statement, the useless robot mouse. The prince's cargo door reveled, a broken craft within. The girl I seek can fix a ship. So, who'd like to begin? He gave the sonic socket wrench to one and then the other. Alas, they couldn't fix the ship, and neither could their mother. But Cinderella struggled, but the space rope held her tight till Murgatroyd's robotic teeth cut through it with one bite. The ship, it's leaving. Wait, what's this? She made a fast repair, then strapped the rusty jetpack on and blasted through the air. She landed right beside the prince. That wrench is mine, she cried. She quickly fixed the alien ship. The prince said, be my bride. Let's see, what's she gonna say? What do you think she's gonna say? This has been kind of a different story. She thought this over carefully. Her family watched in panic. I'm far too young for marriage, but I'll be your chief mechanic. Amid her fleet of sparkling ships and friends, both old and new, a joyful Cinderella cried, my star's dreams do come true. And that is the story of Interstellar Cinderella. I really hope that you enjoyed this book. This is one of my favorites, and I really like the play that it has on Cinderella, and I like that she focused on what she wanted to do with her life and how she would rather go into her passions. So let's go ahead, and if if your parents are near, which I'm assuming they are, go ahead and take pinkies with them and let's do a little prayer. Dear God, thank you for everything that you have shown us on how to pursue our passions. And hopefully we will be able to follow your signs for pursuing them in the future. Thank you. Have a good day, guys.
We will now enter into a time of sharing of joys, concerns, and prayer requests.
Okay. Today, Rita M. has a joy that she had a surprise visit from Monique and Marquise, and that made her day. We rejoice with you on that. And then one is my own from Allison. I would like to lift prayers up for Brandy W. She is an old high school buddy who was told this week that she needs to enter into hospice care. She has young children, and let's just lift her and her family up in prayers as they go through this process. And that is what we're seeing for today for joys and concerns.
Couple others that we have to lift up as well is to be with the Graff family in their time of loss. We would also lift up Janine in the recent passing of her husband, Chuck. Our thoughts, our prayers are with you. We also light one candle for the joys and concerns which we have kept to ourselves this morning. God knows what weighs upon our hearts and our minds. We'll have a time of prayer and then a prayer song to follow. So let us pray together. Loving and almighty God, we come before you this day. We lift up our joys to you. We are grateful for the opportunities, the joys, and the happiness which has filled our lives the past day, the past week, past year, or even longer. We are grateful for the many joys which we have within our lives. Those that may seem too small to share in words. We also lift up to the concerns that have been shared here this morning. We pray for your spirit of comfort and of peace to fall upon those who need your reassurance now more than ever. We pray that you be with the family and the friends who are mourning the loss of loved ones or the loved ones who are ill. We pray that you continue to be with them. May they know your presence. May they know our presence, whether we be near or far. We pray for those things which we have kept to ourselves. You know what weighs upon our minds and our hearts, O God, and we lift all these things up to you. Amen and amen.
Dona nobis pacem, pacem. Dona nobis pacem. My soul lifts up the Lord. My spirit celebrates God, my liberator. For though I'm God's humble servant, God has noticed me. Now and forever, I will be considered blessed by all generations. For the mighty one has done great things for me. Holy is God's name. From generation to generation, God's loving kindness endure for those who revere him. God's arm has accomplished mighty deeds. The proud in mind and heart, God has sent away in disarray. The rulers from their high positions of power, God has brought down low. And those who were humble and lowly, God has elevated with dignity. The hungry, God has filled with fine food. The rich, God has dismissed with nothing in their hands. To Israel, God's servant, God has given help, as he promised to our ancestors, remembering Abraham and his descendants in mercy forever.
Have you ever thought about what your favorite Bible passages are? For some, that it may be a new question. For others, it is something that may weigh on your mind frequently. For those of us who have been asked to preach or to teach, it is a common question. Today's scripture, Luke 1, verses 46 through 55, is one of mine. If not my favorite passage, it is definitely near the top of that list. This famous song, or sometimes referred to as Magnificat, is being said and being sung by Mary, or her Hebrew name Miriam, which I will be using for today. These words of power, truth, and praise are spoken by the least likely or significant person within her society, a pregnant, unmarried woman. Yet she remembers how God has fed the hungry when her people wandered the desert. She had been told the stories of how God had brought up the lowly to important places within their history, people such as Moses and Jacob. But it wasn't only a boys' club. There was not just men who were raised up within the tradition, but there was Esther and Sarah and Deborah and so many more. She was also in the physical presence of a prime example of someone whom God had lifted up, her relative, Elizabeth. And she was told of how God had saved the Israelites from the slavery of Egypt. Miriam had celebrated with her family as the Torah was read and the stories retold of the wretched conditions, the plagues that followed, and how God had brought them to the promised land. She sang the songs and she offered the prayers that the elders had taught her and so many before her. Overall, Miriam sang her song of praise within today's scripture to God that told and retold of how God had noticed the plight of the people, both collectively and individually. It served as a reminder to the Israelites and to her family of God's continual care for them. That, perhaps, is the biggest cause for celebration in the midst of troubling news. And God had noticed Miriam. These examples of God uplifting the Israelites from the pits of despair enabled her to trust in God. Faith that this pregnancy would not end in disaster for her or her child or her family. But even more importantly, God had noticed her. She was not as obscure or as invisible as she may have thought. Miriam has come to symbolize many things, and not the least of which should be that the invisible is made visible. She has been pushed to the margins of her society. She is powerless as a poor peasant woman who is pregnant and unmarried, and yet God has seen her and not turned away. How radical is this, that no one is insignificant to God, that everyone counts. This is what we are celebrating today. God has seen and noticed each and every one of us. We are especially recognizing that women have most often been pushed to the side within the Bible, within Christianity, and within society. And we are celebrating that they have been seen and noticed by God. The struggle for visibility is real. We belong to a denomination where there are churches who still today will not consider a woman as a pastor. And we are in the year 2020. That fact should both sadden and infuriate us, regardless of our sexual identity. And if we want to move forward as a congregation and as a denomination, then we need to do something more than simply shaking our heads at the situation. Men, I'm talking to you here. We've had our chance in Christianity for a couple millennia, and now it's our turn, or it's our time to step back and give women the opportunity to step forward. God has heard the women crying out and seen you when it seemed that no one had. You are not invisible. You are noticed. You are loved. And we would not be the same without you and your voice. I do not want to spend a lot of time mansplaining this, but for women to know that they are vital. We all have the responsibility of assisting in the work and looking out for the Miriams that exist in our midst. They are all around us if we take the time to notice them, and we must notice them. The places where we see them are not necessarily where they would choose to be, but places where they have been placed against their choosing. They cannot remain invisible. They need to know that they matter to us as they certainly matter to God. We also need to recognize the gifts and talents that they may wish to share with us. Then we should create the opportunities, make space for those gifts and talents to be used, and encourage them as they venture forth. We can be the ones that will help the caterpillar turn into the butterfly. What will the world be like when the invisible are noticed? What will the world be like when women are noticed for who they are? Look at what happened in our scripture, after our scripture for today. Look at what happened when God noticed Miriam in today's text, in the verses before, and certainly in the verses and the chapters that will follow. She was more than a birthing vessel. She taught Jesus. She exemplified God's love to Jesus and to others. She told him the stories. She taught him the traditions. She helped him to memorize the prayers and to celebrate the feast. She encouraged him into his ministry. She was there at the end of his ministry. She was there in the times in between as well. And after the time of his ministry had come to an end, her vitalness was still there. She was still vital as she mentored, encouraged, and taught a new generation of disciples and believers that continues to today. We need to recognize, to look, to see, and to notice the Miriams that are in our midst. Amen. and amen.
Voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure enough. Am I more than just the sum of every high and every
Pretty women wonder where my secret lies.
I'm not cute or built to suit a fashion model size. But when I start to tell them, they think I'm telling lies.
I say, it's in the reach of my arms,
the span of my hips,
the stride of my step and the curl of my lips.
I'm a woman.
Phenomenally.
Phenomenal woman.
That's me.
Men themselves have wondered what they see in me. They try so much, but they can't touch my inner mystery. When I try to show them, they say they still can't see.
I say, it's the arch of my back, the sun of my smile, the ride of my breast, the grace of my style. I'm a woman.
Phenomenally. Phenomenal woman.
That's me.
I walk into a room just as cool as you please. And to a man, the fellows stand or fall down on their knees. Then they swarm around me, a hive of honeybees. I say,
it's the fire in my eyes and the flash of my teeth, the swing in my waist and the joy in my feet. I'm a woman.
Phenomenally. Phenomenal woman.
That's me.
Now you understand just why my head's not bowed.
I don't shout or jump about or have to talk real loud. When you see me passing, it ought to make you proud.
I say, it's in the click of my heels, the bend of my hair,
the palm of my hand, the need for my care, 'cause I'm a woman.
Phenomenally. Phenomenal woman. That's me.
That's me.
That's me.
That's me.
That's me. Pretty women wonder where my secret lies.
Thank you to everyone who created that video and the reading of the poetry. As you go forth this week, know that you are noticed by God and by us. May we also notice those around us. May we value them and the gifts that they have, the gifts that they share. Go this week knowing that you are loved for who you are. Amen and amen.
I am woman, hear me roar, in numbers too big to ignore, and I know too much to go back and pretend. 'Cause I've heard it all before, and I've been down there on the floor. No one's ever gonna keep me down again. Whoa, yes, I am wise, but it's wisdom for the pain. Yes, I paid the price, but look how much I gained. If I have to, I can do anything. I am strong. It only serves to make me more determined to achieve my final goal. And I come back even stronger, not a novice any longer, 'cause you deepen the conviction in my soul. Oh yes, I am wise, but it's wisdom for the pain. Yes, I pay the price, but look how much I stand.